finished our series called Your Story, and we've been trying to make some decisions these past few weeks. Week one was a decision to start some type of discipline that will help us physically, spiritually, emotionally. We talked about stopping something that we need to stop. And then lastly, we talked about sometimes if the best decision is to stay when it would be easier to go. Remember, the decisions you make today determine the type of story you'll tell tomorrow about your life, because we all have a story. We all have different chapters we would rather not think about. We have chapters we enjoy, and I want my story to be a good one. You know, when I worked in Wilmington, we lived in a subdivision that was close to the graveyard. It was a really big graveyard, and back when I used to run every day, I'd get up and run, and I'd go to the graveyard to run, and to me, it's kind of weird, but that's what I did. There's not a lot of cars there, you know, you don't have to worry about getting hit. I mean, if you did, I guess they could just bury you right there, I don't know. Sometimes when I was taking a break, I would just walk by the headstones and just think about, man, I wonder what this person's life is like. We've got that dash there, we've all heard that, you know, that illustration of the dash. I wonder what their life was like. And some of the people that were in there, I knew what that dash was because I knew them. In fact, after we had left, one of our neighbors had passed away. And I got to see her headstone about a year later or so after she passed. Her name was Trudy. And Trudy was this spunky, short German lady. And that fed 25 raccoons every day. Yeah, it was bad. Like, there were raccoons all over her neighborhood, and it's because of Trudy. She took care of her raccoons. I know. Like, Trudy, you really need to stop doing that, because I had a raccoon in my garage one morning. So, she didn't. But anyways, Trudy, her story was quite interesting. Not that your stories aren't. I mean, every story is unique in its own way. But I'd go to Trudy's house just to listen to her talk. One, because of her accent, but two, because of the stories she had to tell. She was a teenager during World War II, and she lived in Germany, and she's a German. During World War II, she was 12 or 13 years old, and she had just some crazy stories to tell. So I just remember sitting there at her house, picking her brain about what life was like in Germany in World War II and all that was going on, and she would talk about how the Russians killed her grandfather when they came in and invaded Germany, and how her and her sister were displaced and trying to find a place to live. And I had one question for her, though. I was like, you know, Trudy, this is like eating at me. How did you not know that they were exterminating groups of people? Like, how could you not know that? And she said, They hit it very well. So we didn't know they had these, you know, these camps. So we really thought they were work camps. And she said, one day, my sister and I were walking, and we saw them taking a group of people to the woods. And she said, we thought that was weird. Like, why would you take this group of people to the woods? They knew it's just woods and then more woods, and there's no towns out that way. And so her sister, just being curious, she went up to one of the officers, one of the soldiers, and said, why are you taking those people to the woods? And she said, the soldier looked at us and said, shut your mouth or you'll be going with them. And she's like, then we knew, okay, there's something not right here. And of course, she just talks about wartime. She talks about being, the Allies coming in. Fortunately, she was with the American side. And what that experience was like, and then going to America, she married a soldier, and she'll tell you about when she learned English. She said, all the first words you learn in English are all the cuss words. She's like, so I can't tell you all the new words I learned when I first learned English. Because the soldiers, they were just teaching us all the bad ones. And she talked about, you know, when she came to Christ and difficult times in her life, like when her son died when he was 21 in a car accident. She loves Jesus. She loved her church. And she's just a faithful, wonderful woman. There's no books going to be written about her. you didn't know she existed until this morning. So I can walk by her headstone, and I probably will on Tuesday in any moment. And I can look at her dash, and I know her story. There's lots of people, though, I walk by and think about their life. What was their life like? What was the struggles that they had? Because we all have a story. We have the ups and the downs, and we have the difficulty, but man, I want my story to be a good one. And the decisions that you make today, they determine the story that you will tell. And so today, the challenge is going to be that, you know, sometimes the best decision is to go when you would rather stay. Last week we talked about the best decision is to stay when you would rather go. I'm not going to rehash that sermon. It's on our website, bridgeway.church. But sometimes the best decision is to go when it would be easier to stay. And we're going to talk about that little circle we create for ourselves, a bubble, so to speak, of comfort and ease. And that's not where our growth happens. It's always this step of going, where the only guarantee is God will be with you. You're not even guaranteed things are going to go the way you picture them. Your only guarantee is we know who our God is and that He is with us. And so we are challenged, and hopefully you'll be challenged today, to have that bubble here, but to be willing to step out of it without God giving you all the details of how it's going to work out. How do we live a life worth having a story to tell about? We go to Hebrews chapter 12, our main text. Therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us. You know what that sin is, and you need to stop it. You know it. We talked about this already. And let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Remember, you determine how you run this race. No one else is going to run this race for you. It's up to you. Looking unto Jesus. If you want a story that's worth telling, you have to do those first three words. Look unto Jesus. Look unto Jesus. Look unto Jesus. The author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. I want a story worth telling. I want people, if they walk by my headstone, to say, you know, if they knew me, that he was not a perfect man, but he loved Jesus, he was faithful, he was obedient, he loved his family, served his church. I want it to be a good story. You're going to have a story no matter what, let's be honest. There will be a story of your life. I want it to be worth telling. So we're going to meet Abraham today. We've been looking at different Old Testament examples. We've talked about Moses. We've talked about Daniel. We've talked about Ruth. We're going to talk about Abraham today. You all remember Abraham? Well, maybe you don't. We did this in the early service, so we'll do it in the early service. You guys remember the Sunday school song? Father Abraham? You guys know what I'm talking about. All right. I'm going to bust it out. Would you like to stand up or would you rather sit down? Let's sit down. Okay. I got the same look in the early service. They're like, we're not standing up. So, this is how it goes. Remember? Father Abraham. And his sons had Father Abraham. I am one of them. And so are you. So let's just praise the Lord right on. And then you would go through the whole thing again. Your left arm, right leg, nod your head, turn around, sit down. Yeah, good job. Give yourself a hand. Father Abraham. We're going to talk about him today and the step of faith that he took. He wasn't always a follower of the one true God. He lived in Ur of the Chaldees, and they worshipped the moon god. So what happens with Abraham? Well, his name at this point is Abram. That gets changed later on. But let's take a look at Genesis chapter 12. It says, now the Lord had said to Abram, get out of your country for your family and your father's house, from your family and your father, from your father's house, to a land that I will show you. I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse him who curses you. And in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. Okay. Where did God, in those three verses, where did he tell Abraham they were moving? He doesn't tell him. This is the crazy part about it, right? He tells Abraham, I'm going to make you a great nation. Everyone's going to be blessed because of this nation. So you need to leave. We need to leave where you live. Amen. Okay, God, where are we going? I'm not going to tell you right now. Well, think about this. He gets home from work. Sarah's making something to eat. How was your day? Oh, it wasn't too bad. I had a good conversation with God. Oh, really? What was that about? Well, God wants us to move because we're going to be this great nation, and everybody's going to be blessed because of us. So let's get the packing boxes out. Now, maybe Sarah was like, you know, I have gotten tired of Ur. I'd really not live in a place called Ur, right? Oh, maybe we'll get out of town. Where are we going? I don't know. God has not told us where we're going to move. So when we pack everything up, which direction do we go? I have no idea. Let's just pick a direction and just move that way. What about the rest of our, you know, our extended family and all that? Are they going to come? No, it's just us. They're going to leave their what they know. They're going to leave their family, their traditions. I mean, they're going to leave everything. And God doesn't give them all the details. And friends, if you're waiting on God to give you all the details of your step of faith, you're going to be waiting a long time. Most often, He's not going to give you all the details. Why do we crave the details? Why do we want God to just unfold all of it right before us and say, hey, if you take this step, this is exactly what's going to happen for all of this? Why do we want that? It's because we love to have control. We don't like when things are out of our control. That's why we want the details. God, give me all the insight here. And God's like, nah, I'm not going to give it all to you. You are going to have to learn to trust me. And for that, you're just going to have to go. But God, we don't know where we're going. I know you don't. And figure it out. I mean, the principle is simple. You can't get over there by staying here. In your face, if you're in this little bubble where you finally arrived and you think things are comfortable and things are safe, but you know God is pricking your heart to take some type of step of faith. And it looks different for all of us. It can be in your relationships. It can be at work. It can be with your church. You can fill the blank in, but if God's pricking your heart to take some type of a step, it's easier to stay, right? This is safe. This is comfortable. But that's not where our growth takes place. It takes place when we step out. You've got to leave this little bubble of security and step out into the destiny, really, of what God has in store for you. You're not going to know what that is if you don't take a step. Abraham's a bit of an old guy at this time, right? I mean, he's 75. He's as old as Gary. Gary's in the back, so I can talk bad about him. He can see us, but you know. He's 75. He could have easily had justifications. We all have justifications to stay in this bubble, right? You're like, God, I'm old. I mean, I've lived my life, and I really don't feel like doing this. I mean, maybe Abraham's just like, this world owes it to me because I've been pouring myself out my whole life, and I deserve to be able to take it easy. We always have a justification, a rationale in our mind to stay in this bubble. He's 75. No one else is going to blame him, right? Sometimes that's our train of thought. I mean, everyone else is going to agree with me. This is probably a bit of a crazy step. When it comes to steps of faith, it's not the opinions of others that matters. It's the command of God on your life, okay? We're only worrying about what everyone else is going to say or do. Remember, you're to look unto Jesus, the author and finisher of your faith. So, here's the issue. God's made a promise to Abraham. You ever made promises to God? Like, God, if you do this, I promise I will go to church every Sunday. I'll even somewhat listen during announcement time and sign up for a small group. If you'll just do this, get me out of this mess. Anybody done that? I know I have. Made promises to God. Did you guys keep them 100% of the time? I know I didn't. Like one pastor said, he said, we're not changed by making promises to God. It doesn't change you to make a promise to God. We are changed by believing God's promises to us. That's where we're changed. We're not changed by saying, God, I promise I'll do this if you do this. That doesn't change us. In fact, more often than not, we're not going to keep our end of the deal anyway. We are changed when we simply say, God, I'm going to trust you and trust what you said. I'm going to believe your promises. So, what does Abraham do? These first three words in verse 4. You're going to underline anything? These first three words. Genesis 12:4. So he's just told, he said, okay, we're going to move, we're going to go. So Abraham departed. Boom. Right there. So he departed. I'm going to go. God said go. So he spoke to him and Lot went with him, and Abraham was 75 years old when he departed from Haran. Now we have the benefit of being able to read Abraham's story. But in your story, if we got to Genesis 12:4 in your book, what are the first three words going to say? Would they say, so he departed? Or would they say, so he stayed? This is like a pivotal thing, right? I mean, imagine if Abraham decides not to go. And he's like, no, this is just too crazy. I got my business here. I've got all, I'm going to stay. Well, you couldn't call God the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, right? Those guys wouldn't be around. He decides to obey. See, here's the thing. You can be inside this comfort zone, this bubble. You're not going to know what the blessings or the experiences you're going to have if you decide to step out. There are things about God you will learn out this way. There are things you learn about yourself out this way. You learn to trust him in ways you never could before. Your growth happens there. It doesn't happen over here in this bubble. Once you take that step, there are things that God can do that he's not going to do over here. So fast forward it. What type of step of faith do you need to take? Is it with your job or sharing Christ with someone that you're nervous about doing, or restoring a relationship, or serving in different capacity, or I don't know. Fast forward the possibilities of what those blessings could look like. What does it look like? I was sharing with the early service. I've run through this, especially since we have one more Sunday in this building. But a lot of times I think, what if we decided never to start the church? Now, God, he can use anybody he wants. He probably would have chosen someone else other than Abraham and got a different route. Okay? I'm just talking about what he's done and just from my perspective. What if we had stayed in Wilmington and just chilled out there? Which would have been easier to do. That would have been easier, all right? There was a lot of security there. In fact, before starting Bridgeway, I had a meeting, and it was basically, okay, you've been here 5 years, and if you want to stay, kind of here's the package of what this looks like for you. And it looked very, very secure and very comfortable, I will tell you that, financially speaking and otherwise. So, wow. All right. And this isn't, I'm not trying to toot my horn, I'm just telling you God's work in my life, okay? Because the steps of faith that we take are all different. And I'm not saying mine's greater than the others. Like, the step of faith that God might have you take might seem small to you, but in the long run, it could be a huge step. A job or a family or whatever. I'm knocking stuff down. But anyways, so I'm offered this wonderful, secure package, but it wasn't what God had for us. But I often think, what if we had stayed? And I'll share with the early service, if we had stayed, I would have never met a guy like Bill Steinker. Debbie was here. And she talked to me after service about it a little bit, too. Bill hated church. He despised it, really. He had a horrible experience in his younger years. And the only reason Bill visited Bridgeway was someone I went to church with in Wilmington was Bill's friend and said, hey, there's a new church here. I'll sit with you if you want to come check it out. Because Bill at that time had about 6 months to live. So Bill came, and Bill was not the guy who was going to believe this just because he was dying. And he would tell you that. He wanted to know if this was true or not. He wanted to know if this, all this Jesus stuff was actually real. And if he wasn't convinced, then he wasn't going to go with it. I came in, I would never have met Bill. Bill had a profound impact in my life. Just in the short amount of time I got to know Bill. A fascinating man. So I'd go over there and we'd play pool. I wouldn't let him win, seriously speaking. I wouldn't. Bill is a very competitive guy. And, I mean, he's in his scooter, shaking, and still kicking my butt at pool, right? So either he's really good, or I'm really bad. And so I'm going with he's really good. We'd also sit and we'd play chess and talk about things in life and faith. And we'd talk about when his wife died unexpectedly, and here he is trying to raise kids now, and alone, and he talks about meeting Debbie and his, just his story. He talks about growing up and how faith was something that, he got a wrong impression of because of how, people had treated him. And Debbie was telling me after service, people would stop by our house to talk about church and stuff, and Bill would invite him in, and he said his only goal with those conversations was to try to just destroy any belief that person had, just to basically prove them wrong. But eventually, I'm sitting at Bill's dining room table, enjoying an orange cream soda, which I bummed off of him. I mean, it was that or a Budweiser. I mean, which one should the pastor be drinking, right? So I have an orange cream soda, and Bill and I are sitting there, and he's like, you know what? I think I'm ready for this. We'd had several conversations. And he came to faith in Christ. And up to his dying day, he served Jesus. How many of you guys remember Bill on his scooter outside the door? You remember that? And he would fist bump you. He wasn't going to shake your hand because if he shook your hand, he was afraid he'd get sick. Because his immune system was so shot. So he'd have gloves on and he'd just be fist bumping everybody, wanting to serve the Lord the best that he could. And so I think once we get to heaven, he'll be standing up and fist bumping us as we make our way in, But yeah, maybe I never would have met Bill Steinker. Because we have this bubble here, and we often fail to realize that even though it's scary when we take a step, it doesn't just change us, it doesn't just impact us, it impacts others. What step do you need to take? And listen, you're not going to be 100%. I talked to some church planners who are like, yeah, I knew 100%, this is what I was supposed to be doing. But I wish I would have, I've never been 100% about any of this. If we're going to the school, am I 100%? No. I was probably like 90% when we started Bridgeway. But then there's that 10% like, I have to, this is serious, thinking crazy. What are we doing? I don't know if it's going to work. The only question you really need to ask when it comes to those hurdles, whether moving to the school or a crazy step of faith in your life, the only question you need to ask is, what does God want me to do? What do I believe he wants me to do? That's really it. You're not guaranteed it's going to work. You're not guaranteed it's going to be successful. It's okay. Is this what God wants us to do? Okay. So why often do we stay here, though? Like, you guys, you hear what I'm saying, but you're like, oh, yeah, I know, but I'm staying right here. So often do we stay right here? Why do we do that? I think it's a couple reasons. I think we're insecure with ourselves. We think it's, I don't have the ability, I can't do this. But remember, it's not about you, it's about God working through you. You can't do it. I can't do it. But I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. Okay, let's keep that in mind. You are not the main object here. Jesus is the main object. Are you afraid of what others might say? Like, man, that is a crazy, crazy step. Then maybe this. You believe that's what God wants you to do. Are you going to have 100% of the details figured out? No. There's always going to be that 10% of just, oh man, I'm scared. But is this what you want me to do? Are you afraid of what people might say to you or say about you? Or maybe you're just one of those folks who say, I'll do it later. I'll do it later. I got too many things going on in my life. I'm raising my kids. I'm doing this, but I'm busy. I can't get involved and serve effectively because it's not a perfect time in my life. There will never be a perfect time in your life. We will always have an excuse. We will always have in our minds a proper justification of why we can't. As my old basketball coach would say, excuses are like armpits. Everybody's got two and they both stink. We always have a justification of why in this period of my life. So for those of us raising kids, we're like, well, I'm too busy. I got this massive schedule and I got this and that. I can't be involved because of this or that. Okay, and then we finally get rid of our kids. Like, oh, fine, things can slow down. I've just been so busy, I need to take some time to rest. I don't want to bog my schedule down again because, man, I did that when I had my children and stuff. And then, you know, we move into our later years. We're like, I'm not able to do all those things. And maybe you're not, but maybe you are able to do some of those things. And you're just saying, you know, I've served, you know, I've been busy for so long for this or that, and I just need to take it easy. There's always an excuse. Don't buy it. You're going to get to the end of your story, and there's going to be chapters filled with excuses. I prefer to have chapters filled with unexpected blessings because I trusted God, even though I wasn't sure how it was going to turn out. I get it. Life is busy. But if you are a Christian, you filter your priorities through Jesus. That's a given, right? This isn't really even up for debate. If you are a follower of Jesus, then you are saying that Jesus gets to dictate my schedule. He gets to dictate my life. He gets to dictate what I watch, what I listen to, where I go, how I do things. You've given him that permission because you follow him. So if your schedule's too busy, it's your own fault. Get your priorities straight with God. Be serious about your faith. If this is just some Sunday routine that you just show up and you check it off, then don't come back. This is not the place for you. There are plenty of places where you can sit and do nothing and repeat the process. I don't want that to be us. And really, especially since we're moving, that's created a mound of more work for us. I'm excited about it because so many people have decided, hey, I'll help, I'll serve, I'll work. It's more beneficial for us to go and set up and tear down and do all those things than I think it is for us to just leave this stuff up all the time. You know? What step of faith do you need to take? Ask yourself this question real fast. Is my life pleasing to God? My life pleasing to God? I'll tell you how to answer that question. Hebrews 11:6. Without faith, it is impossible to please Him. Without faith, your life isn't pleasing to God. Oh, man, I'm a nice person. I'm not doing these bad things, and so on and so forth. You're not walking by faith. I trust in God in every aspect of your life. Your life isn't pleasing. I didn't say that. He did. We find out about Abraham in this chapter, in verse 8. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to the place which he would receive as an inheritance. And he went out, not knowing where he was going. He went out, not knowing where he was going. I mean, think about it. He invites his friends over to help him move because that's what you do with your friends, right? You got to move this sleeper sofa, so I need some help here. So, where are you and Sarah heading out to, bud? I have no idea. You don't have, like, a deposit on a place or anything like that? No. I have no freaking clue. And why are you moving? Because God wants us to. You know you're crazy, right? I'm going to close with a very familiar passage of Scripture. It has the word in it that we are focused on today. not on your screen. So I just thought of it. Not everything's pre-planned here. In Matthew 28, it says, Jesus came and spoke to them. Who's the them in this? So often we think it's, okay, it's got to be like the preachers and, you know, all the apostles and all these leaders. Yeah, they were there, but it was also what we would call just regular folk, you know, we're all regular folk. So this is him speaking to you, okay? Keep that in mind, and me. So we're all sitting in the same crowd. Jesus is saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Why is he telling you this? Because he's saying, hey, everything you need, I got it, okay? Stop freaking out. Get your priorities right, because most often the reason our priorities aren't straight is because we don't trust God like we should. Like, God, I can't do this because this might happen, or that might happen. And he's saying, hey, I got your back. And he's never failed anybody. Remember, the growth doesn't come in you making promises to God. It comes from you believing the promises of God. So all authority is given to me in power in heaven and earth. Go, therefore. Remember when you're reading the Bible, you see a therefore? It's referring to what has previously been said. Because all power and authority has been given to Christ, we're to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you, and though I'm with you all, even until the end of the age. So, this great commission is given to all of us. You have a story to tell, and you're going to have this gap, and maybe one day some weird guy who runs in graveyards is going to think, I wonder what their story was like. And there is a story there. And I hope it's a story of faith. I hope it's a story of someone who, yeah, had some bad chapters, had some great chapters, but overall, their story was a person who trusted God, walked by faith, and not by sight. I hope that's you as an individual. I hope it's us as a church. We all got a story.